Hey, ViteConf, I'm Ben Holmes, and I'm here to talk about local first apps. This is a new buzzword you may not... Oh, shoot, I'm getting a phone call. Let me click on this. Whiteboard guy?
Hey.
What's up? How's it going?
What's up? I'm on my Island's architecture vacation.
Yeah, it looks like you're getting a lot of sun out there.
Thanks. Yeah, and I see you're giving a talk.
Yeah.
But like, come on, slides? You can do better than that. Let me say something.
All right. Okay. Yeah, go ahead and send me... You have Discord. Okay. Well, let me just download that.
Yeah, check it out. And best of luck on the talk.
Yeah, take it easy, man.
Subscribe to my YouTube.
Crazy guy. Never lets me do what I want to do. Well, all right, no more slides. Let's go ahead and see what this repository is. And okay, yeah, we're working with VS Code here. We've got just an index Astro starting from the HTML document, keeping it simple. And we have, all right, we have a search bar. We have a SQLite file. Okay, we might be working with local apps. And down here, we have a script tag where we're just initializing a database. Did he get this backwards? Is this supposed to go on the server? Why are we doing a database on the client? Okay, let me click into this. I see we're using Drizzle, so that works in the client, apparently. Today, I learned. We're also using SQL Local. I've heard of this before. I was just looking at it. This is a way to set up SQLite in the browser. And it's using the origin private file system to store it in your browser across sessions. And it's not as scary as it sounds. This is a file system that Google Chrome keeps track of for you, or Firefox or whatever. So you don't have to ask for someone's downloads folder. You can just store files on their behalf. Really cool. And we're just taking this database from the tutorial and we're creating a new one inside of here. Then we're creating a new table. So we're working with documents, so it's probably like a document store, title, text, vector, so maybe LLM related, I don't know. And then down here we have a migration file to create that table if it doesn't exist in your browser. Okay, sounds simple. And we're also keeping track of whatever ID you're looking at with the hash. So if you say like hash one at the end of a URL, we want to take that and use it as the ID to go look up the document in the database. Let's implement looking up a document in a database. So we can create a document, we can go to DB, select from docs, and we can say where, yeah, something like that, Copilot. We'll look for the docs ID, and if they're equal, we'll take that document, display it to the user. And otherwise, it means we just don't have a document in the database. So let's insert a new one with the title untitled and redirect you to that new document instead. Then to display it to people, yeah, we'll use the title and text. These are two elements that are selected at the top right here by ID. And that's it. So now if we go back to our dev server, which I think I have running, I do. Okay, so this creates a new document, redirects me to the ID, and I can type stuff. But if I refresh, we're not able to see those changes. Makes sense, we're not actually persisting those updates. So let's add a few more clauses in here. We'll take that title input, and Copilot's way ahead of me, of course, but we'll take that title, we'll look for inputs, and we'll set the text content to whatever that text is. And we'll do the exact same thing for this guy. Whenever you input body text, we'll update the document store as well. If it's empty or something, we probably want to handle that as well. Beauty of type safety, you always get things checked. Head back over here, let's adjust this, you know, my first post. Refresh, there it is. My content, refresh, there it is. Okay, so now we have a basic document editor in one file of JavaScript, kind of crazy. But I'm not really creative enough to come up with a whole bunch of documents since we want to implement search. So let's just figure out uploading a SQLite file into the browser. Should help with debugging as well. So I'm hoping Whiteboard Guy gave us a little alias to work with. He sure did. Okay, so this is gonna take that file input and let us upload that file into the file system. So this is the low-level API in the browser. We're not importing anything to go to that file and write to it. And this works just like writing a file in Node. You can iterate over like a stream of chunks coming from wherever. You can write it to that database and then reload the window. So we're gonna go ahead and do that. I think Whiteboard Guy gave us an example database. Yes, so in this repository, we have data/example. You can do so as well when you try out the repository at home. If we upload that, boom, now all of a sudden we have a document store and we're looking at Laravel. Well, that's really not my favorite one. Let's see what's at position 3. Okay, this is the good stuff. All right, try out Astro Build today. That's the good one. Okay, so I think we have like 3 or 4 documents in here. Yeah, we have something about RSCs. Document 1 is this. Cool. But we can't find these easily. I don't want to type a hash. I want to implement like a search bar. And I think there's the bones of a search bar if I scroll up here. Yeah, okay, we have a dialogue element. And this is a native element in the browser to just make a pop-up with all the keyboard accessibility. Love that. So let's implement the JavaScript to expose this dialogue whenever you click on the button that we have at the top, this search button. Let's start by selecting all of those search elements, and we'll set up this trigger to display the dialogue. I'll just add it wherever. Search trigger, click, add event listener, and that will show the modal. Again, browser native, love it. And it manages focus state for us, so we don't even need that. And we head back over here, we can see, boom, search pops up right for us. And you know what? Let's make it a little bit fancier, because people are saying you need frame or motion in order to make search dialogues look good. Well, let me show you what a view transition can do. This is just using browser native view transitions if they're available. Otherwise, just show it. We can see right now, boom, beautiful fade. And we could add CSS to make this as fancy as we want to, but I'm pretty happy with that fade. Let's implement the search though. Let's not get distracted. I'll set up our search input right here, add event listener for inputs. Our query comes from the search value. And our results come from a basic text search, and we'll implement that here. Down at the bottom, we have text search set up, and it looks like Whiteboard Guy just said, let's use the like operator. I agree, you can set up search tables, but you know, we only have 15 minutes. Let's make it simple. We'll select from the docs, and yeah, use the like operator from Drizzle to select anything that has the query somewhere inside of, let's say the title, just to keep it simple. Now let's display those results to the user. Again, we're just using HTML, empty it out, and render some list items with the ID and the title. Last, let's collapse the dialogue whenever that changes. You can listen for changes on a route with just hash change. And we'll add a little view transition sauce every time you navigate around. Love a little sauce. We'll say searchDialog.close so that we can display the new item. All right, so let's search inside of here, and yeah, look at that. So it's searching for Astro, Laravel, RSCs. Click on an item, beautiful transition. Okay, so now we have full document search, but I'm not super satisfied with this because yeah, it works for basic search, but what if you're searching for something kind of similar? Like, I remember Astro is a really awesome framework that I should use, but what was it called again? Is it called Spaceman? No, that's not it. It's called Comet, Meteor. Oh, it's Astro. Okay, there it is. So you can get there, but you can imagine if you can't quite get the words for it, we want to surface results that are similar to whatever the search query was. And not just fuzzy search, actually using an LLM to figure out what the similar items are. And I saw Whiteboard Guy hinting at it with this universal sentence encoder. This is coming from TensorFlow, which is an LLM that Google created to perform similar text search. You can use it for all sorts of things, but the sentence encoder will serve our purposes. And to boot it up, you can just load directly from the registry. Okay, Whiteboard Guy couldn't figure out how to get Vite working, so we're just gonna load it from the third party, but if you can figure it out, definitely do so. And we can boot up the model just by calling the load function. This is available on a global object, and once the model's loaded, we'll place it into that variable and initialize some things in a moment. I'll show you the network activity for this. Since we're loading a pretty large model, you're gonna see quite a lot of activity down here as it loads all of these shards and gets you 36 megabytes of LLM goodness. As you can imagine, that's a lot of data, so make sure you load it asynchronously, maybe in a web worker, and have some sort of progressive enhancement so people can use your website while it loads. And we'll implement all of that here. We're gonna iterate over all of our elements and look for the ones that don't have a vector assigned yet. And for each of them, we'll run our LLM across the text. So we'll take our vector, we'll create an embedding from the title here, and an embedding is converting a string of text into a sequence of numbers that an LLM can use to decide how similar two bits of text are. And we can store this directly back into our database, placing the vector directly in there, and I set up a nice adapter to convert an array of data into a blob so SQLite is happy. With those vectors populated, we can implement a search algorithm. We'll start by checking if the model even exists, and if it does, we'll create another one of those embeddings. This is taking your search query and also converting it to a sequence of numbers to see how similar the two are. Then we'll query for all of the data inside of our database because we're not running vector search inside of the database, we're running it in memory. So yes, this could be an expensive operation, but it's a small database, we can do it for now. And we'll iterate over all those and compute similarities. And this is gonna get into a bit of mathematics. So we have this cosine similarity function that's gonna compute how similar two vectors are. And since it's a cosine, we're looking at values between 1 and negative 1. So 1 means things are super similar, 0 means they're not similar at all, or orthogonal if you've heard that before, and negative 1 means they're polar opposites. We also want to handle when there's not a vector and just say it's not similar at all. Now we're ready to wire up this search. So you remember earlier we had our text search implemented. Let's add a little progressive enhancement. So if AI has booted up, let's use a vector search to make things super awesome. And if AI is still loading, we'll fall back to text search, no harm done. Heading back to the browser, you can see our beautiful LLM is booting up. And if we look at our search results, you can see things are actually loading from an LLM. Things are even resorting themselves as I type, very cool. Let me add a little bit of feedback so you know what we're working with as well. This will log out that similarity number. So you can see if we type the perfect string, it's gonna be 1, super similar. But if we type something kind of close like spaceman, Astro still comes up, look at that. We could type like authentication and that should bring up like backend and Laravel. And if we type, I don't know, Lambo, that should bring Laravel, okay. All right, Astro developers getting Lambos, we like that. Laravel, you're at number 2, you gotta keep up according to Google. Okay, so in all honesty, it's only as good as the dictionary you give it. So if you have internet humor to match results, it's not gonna be perfect. But if you're looking for synonyms, it's the best thesaurus that you can find. So that's really the whole demo. We put SQLite in the browser, we put AI in the browser, and I'll leave you with this parting thought of how far things can go. You can actually load entire AI chatbots and models in the browser too. I was trying out Gemma the other day, which is like Gemini Mini, and it's a 2 gigabyte model. Like we are going way beyond the bounds of what you should probably put in the browser, but it's pretty promising that you can get comparable performance to a real engine all running on your computer without having to contact a third party or pay for their bills. So really excited for this on-device compute future that we're leaning towards. And Astro is the perfect place to try it. You can use whatever component framework you want. You can write one big script tag and just run with view transitions like I did here. Also clone the repo to go on your own adventures with it. With that, enjoy the rest of ViteConf.